Mechanics of solids is a subject which deals with the stresses and strains happening on various components when it is acted upon by a set of forces. So in this session we will discuss about the stress at a point. Before we move into the discussion of stress, we have to understand what are the different types of load which is acting on a component. The external loads are generally classified into surface force and body force. The surface forces are the one which are caused by the direct contact of one body with the surface of another. Majority of the forces that are experienced on an engineering component are surface forces. The another force that we have to discuss is the body force, which is developed when one body exerts a force on the other. The example for the body force is the gravitational pull that we all experience, and the result is nothing but weight. So when we consider a body which is acted upon by a set of forces, let us consider that on a particular surface there is a force acting like this. When we reduce this particular area to a strip, we can say that this is a distributed load. This is a linearly distributed load. And if we change this line to a point, we can say that this surface force has changed to a linear force, then again to a concentrated load. This is how we idealize the surface forces, the linearly distributed forces and concentrated forces. Even though in mechanics we have learned about different types of forces like point load, UDL, uniformly varying load, we haven't gone through the idealization process. So this is how it is being idealized. Now we have to discuss about the surface reaction. Why we need to discuss surface reaction, or how the surface reaction develops in the material? The answer is very simple. See, if you consider a roller support, we can see that this particular roller is free to move in the x direction on to either two directions, either directions. But the motion of this roller is arrested in the y direction. It cannot move in the y direction. It cannot move in this direction. So whenever the motion is arrested in some particular direction, a reaction will develop at that particular direction. So here the y direction is arrested, so we have a reaction in the y direction. Similar the case in the pinned support. So when you look at the pinned support, you can see the motion in the x direction as well as the motion in the y direction is arrested. So we have two reactions, one in the y direction and another one in the x direction. So even if you arrest a moment, or if you arrest the rotational effect of a body, then definitely there will be a moment reaction. And in this figure it is clearly shown. This particular anti-clockwise arrow represents a reactional moment. It is developed just because this fixed support arrested the x motion, y motion and the rotational effect. So when you go through the pinned support, the slider or the slider vertical or horizontal or even a smooth surface, the reactions developed when the motion is arrested. That is the simple way of defining it. And since the engineering components are in contact with each other, it has got some restrictions, definitely support reactions will act on the system. So this is a very important type of force system we have to always consider while we study the stresses. So moving forward to the internal resultant load, what is the significance of this internal resultant load? The answer is very simple. We discussed about various loads acting on the surface of the body. But now the question is, what happens inside the body? If we consider a section like this, then we can see that a lot of forces are acting in different directions. So different forces are acting in different directions in this particular cross section. So using the fundamental mechanics principle of equilibrium, using the equilibrium equation, the net force in the x direction, the net force in the y direction, net force in this direction has to be zero, then only the body can be considered in equilibrium. All these equations has to be satisfied in order to state that the body is in static equilibrium. So using the fundamental principles, we can find out by submitting the force in the x direction, y direction, z direction, and taking the resultant, we can convert this particular system of forces into a single force, which is nothing but the resultant. So this entire force is being converted to a single force. This we have learned in the engineering mechanics. We know how to convert the system of forces into a single force and a moment system. So the net effect of this entire system of forces is converted to a single force, which is nothing but a resultant force, and the entire effect or the moment effect of the all these forces are being summed up to the resultant moment. So when we resolve this resultant load and the moment into three mutually perpendicular axes, we have a shear force, we have a normal force, we have a bending moment, and we have a torsional moment. There is no need to get confused about the naming. When we resolve this resultant to the normal direction means normal to the surface. It is named as, or that component of force is named as, the normal force. When we resolve this system, this force into a direction which is parallel to the surface, it is called as a shear force. And when you resolve this momentum into the axial direction or the longitudinal direction, it is a torsional moment because it is creating a kind of twisting on the body. So it is called as a torsional moment. And the one which is resolved to this particular y-axis creates a bending effect on the body. So it is called as the bending moment. So in another simple words, we can say that the way in which a force acts on a body determines the effect that it caused on that body. If a force is acting parallel to a surface, that is causing a shear. If a body is force is acting on a normal to the body, it is experiencing some different effect. So if you change the direction of the force, it will create a bending moment. This is how we have to read a system of forces. These are very fundamental things that you should understand before you moving or stepping into the concept of stress. This is how we consider a cross section, and we resolve the forces within a cross section. Now let us discuss about the stress at a point. If we take the same cross section and if we take a very small area delta A, we have to say that the force is also very small as we change the area to a very small value. And we can resolve this small force into three components again, as the y component, x component, and z component. And if you take another section which is perpendicular to this particular initial section, then another set of forces are being developed in the body. You can see that these two forces are not one of the same. Those two are completely different quantity because the surface we have considered two distinct quantities. So if you take the another plane which is mutually perpendicular to the other two, you can have a three-dimensional effect. And the forces, the resistive forces which are developed within this body on these three surfaces are completely different. So what we can conclude is that as the area decreases to a small value delta A, so the force delta F. But this ratio delta F to delta A is always a finite quantity in a particular cross section. It's very simple. So if you take a cross section, this ratio will be one of the same, and this particular ratio is defined as the stress. So in order to define this stress, we have made two assumptions. One is that the material is continuous. Second is that it is cohesive. Continuous means the material is same throughout the body, and cohesive means every material or the all the units are adhered to each other. Then only the effect of the forces will get transferred within the body. We cannot have a definition of stress with a body which is having a void in it. So this is a very important assumption that we make when we describe the stress at a particular point. So upon concluding, we can say that if we take any cross section in a material, there is a resultant force. That resultant force, which is developed within that body, divided by, or the ratio of that force, resultant force, to the particular cross section that you have considered, is a constant value, and that constant value is nothing but stress. So one thing we can conclude here is that based upon the section that we take, the value of stress is also going to be different. The stresses which is acting on this particular plane, which is perpendicular, is not on the same on the plane which is perpendicular to Y. So if you take the third case, the figure C, these three planes will have three different stresses because the resultant forces are different. The area is different, so the ratio is also different. Now moving forward, we have to conclude that stress is nothing but an internal resistive force per unit area. You should not state the stress as a ratio of force upon area. If you state stress as a quantity which is nothing but force upon area, then stress has to be equal to pressure. Both are different quantities. So stress is nothing but it's an internal phenomenon. It's an internal resistive force per unit area. That has to be stated very clearly when you define a stress. So the unit of stress is nothing but Pascal, which is Newton per meter square. So 1 Pascal is nothing but 1 Newton per meter square. So the various ways in which we express this stress are given here. Sometimes they will give represents the value of stress in kilopascals, or it can be in megapascal, or it can be in gigapascal. These units are very much familiar to you all. So one important correlation that you should keep in your mind when you study the stress is that 1 megapascal is nothing but 1 into 10 power 6 pascal, which is same as 1 newton per mm square. So this is a relation which will help you to solve problems. It's very easy. So if you find any confusion in converting the units, obviously you have to learn the, or you have to master that culture, how to convert the unit. Anyway, for the time being, you can say that 1 megapascal is nothing but 1 newton per mm square. You try to convert the unit, how the conversion are not, that is not being covered here. So moving forward, we have different types of stresses. So we have an axial stress which is acting perpendicular to this surface area and the axial direction, that is called as axial stress. It can be tensile or it can be compressive. If this force is acting in the opposite direction, that means if the force is acting in this direction, it is creating a compressive effect on the body. So then it is called as a compressive stress. We can have shear stress in a body. How the shear stress develop in a body? Shear stress develop in a body just because of the shear forces. If you look here, you can see that these two forces is exerting a shear on this the cross section. If you take this particular cross section, this section here, this red section, so this surface is experiencing a shearing. If you look at the forces, you can see that these forces are equal and opposite, which creates an equilibrium. Definitely these forces are acting parallel to this cross section, so this is nothing but a shear force and it is creating a shear stress within the body. If you consider this particular second figure, this is also the same. When you consider a bolt, this is a single shear plane. You can have a single shear plane here, but that is not the case in this figure. Here you have two shear planes. One is here and second one is here. These two are two shear planes. So this is also a case of shear stress, but it is called as double shear just because it has got two shear areas. And the one which is not that familiar is the bearing stress, which we use to make the calculations easy. So if you consider the surface of this particular bolt and this particular area, both of them are exerting force on each other. In order to calculate the or analyze the stresses in this particular material, it is always better to take the projected area, not the actual circumferential area. Instead, we are going to take the projected area. If you look here, this particular rectangle, which is being highlighted over here, this particular rectangle, this is the projected area of this particular surface of this particular bolt. The projected area is this. So the area is nothing but breadth into length into breadth. So the length is nothing but thickness T, and breadth is nothing but diameter of the bolt. So the area is T into D. So the bearing stress is nothing but P by T into D. So this is generally used for the ease of analysis. There is no other reason to use this kind of bearing stresses. So this is you as an engineer, you should keep all these things in mind, because when you are provided with a particular system, you should be able to differentiate the type of stresses, the type of loads acting on a system. As an engineer, that is the essential quality all should possess. You should understand what is the type of load acting on a system. You should understand what is the effect caused by the load on the system. Then only you will be able to understand and analyze the type of stresses developing in the material. So all these are very fundamental things you should keep in your mind. So the next topic that comes along with the stress is the strain. So before we discuss about strain, you should understand what exactly is a displacement. Displacement is something, the motion of a body from one point to another. Suppose if you consider a point like this, this has moved from this point to this point, and it has occupied a new position like this. When you compare these two, there is no deformation happened to the point, there is no change in the volume, it has simply taken its position from one point to another. So it can have a rotation as well as translation, but the size and the shape has not changed, not affected by this displacement. But what is deformation? If the same point is being transferred from this point to another point with some kind of distortion in the shape, change in the volume, when you compare this, the final point, with the initial point, then that is called as a deformation. Some volume change has to happen in a material. So in the displacement, it is depending only upon a particular coordinate system, but deformation is purely depending upon another point. It is relative to one point. Compared to this point, there is a deformation happened to this point, and there can have a volume change. Majority cases, there will be a volume change. There are few special cases where we don't have a volume change. And after understanding this displacement and deformation concept, we can discuss about the strain, which is nothing but the intensity of deformation, how much intensely the deformation has taken place. So the strain completely depends upon the size of the material and the nature of the material. If you have the same material fabricated into two different sizes, it will give two different strains. It cannot give you a single strain. So like we discussed in the stresses, strain also has a normal component as well as a shear component. So all these things are the fundamental things that you should know about the strain. So if you want to describe the strain mathematically, we have to consider a rod which is acted upon by a force P in the axial direction. So after the application of load, the length of this rod has changed, and the amount of deformation is delta. So the change in length upon original length, that particular ratio is called as the strain. As the unit of numerator and denominator are one and the same, strain is a unitless quantity. So the strain which is happening along the axis is called as the normal strain, and the one which is acting parallel to the surface is called as a shear strain. Generally, shear strains are the one which changes the shape of a body. Distortion is happening to the body. So if you look at this particular image, we can see that some distortion has happened, and the value of the distortion is delta S. So if you take a tan phi of this ball angle, delta S divided by L, and that is nothing but the shear strain. Usually shear strains are represented by using a notation like this, and stresses are defined in notation like this, and the normal strains are generally described like this. This is how the strains are defined. So it is nothing but change in length upon original length, and we have got different type of strains. This is normal strain and a shear strain. So this is the fundamentals about the strain. Now we have to understand what exactly is a small strain analysis. See, when we take an engineering material or an engineering component, when it is acted upon by a set of forces, the value of strain that is developed in the material is very small, that is in the order which is very less than 1. Such kind of analysis is called as small strain analysis. This helps us to calculate the normal stresses in an easy manner. This makes the system more simplified. So all through this course, all through these studies or under this particular course, we will be discussing about the small strain analysis. We are not considering large deformations. When you have to consider the large deformation, the entire analysis pattern changes. So for the time being, you understand that in this subject, everything is considered to be in equilibrium, first point. Second point is that the strain that we have considered is very small in nature. And usually in a material, when it is acted upon by a set of forces, there will be 6 component of stresses and there will be 6 component of strains. And this 6 component of strains will cause a volume change in the body. And the most important point in the session is the definition of stress and the actual meaning of strain. Definition of stress I have already taken. Now about the strain. The point is, strain is a geometrical quantity that is measured using experimental technique. Once obtained, the stress in the body can be determined from material property relation. So here, as a student, you should understand that the strain is the measurable quantity. Strain can be measured. You cannot measure the stress. You don't have an equipment. You can't have a device to measure the stress. The thing that you can measure is always the strain. And after finding the value of strain, using the constitutive equations and the material properties, we find the value of stress. That is a very important point that you should keep in your mind. Stress is a internal phenomenon whose ratio, or the ratio of the force upon area, is constant. And strain is a geometrical phenomenon. It can be measured using experimental technique, and after that, using this particular strain, material properties and constitutive relations, you can easily calculate the stress value. That is how you have to understand the strain. So these are the basic references that I have used for preparing this material. So in the next class, we will discuss about the stress strain curves, and followed by we will discuss about the three-dimensional state of stress. So if you have any doubt, feel free to contact me. So thank you for listening. Bye.